Hey, before I get going, please hit the subscribe button and the notification so you know when I post a new video. All right, let's get to the video. So did you watch it today? Did you look at the movement and volatility today? The vol of vol? This has become my focus area, my go-to every morning when I compare yesterday's to today's, the rate of change between volatility from a previous day to this day. The movements in volatility are so telling of where things are headed. And today, we had about a 6.68% pullback in the vol of vol, so that's the VVIX off of yesterday's close. What does that mean? Have we topped out? If volatility has topped out, then have we bottomed out on stocks? Could be. Seriously, could be. Tomorrow will be interesting. I'm curious to see where it heads to. We've had some earnings reports from Apple, Amazon, and Microsoft today, Thursday the 29th. And so some of those were good earnings. Apple had a bit of an issue because their iPhone sales weren't offset by their iPad sales. So that's a bit of an issue. And we saw aftermarket pullback in that area. But does that present a great opportunity to buy Apple? I mean, it's a great company, diversified portfolio of businesses. You know, is there a better buy point? That's when we go check out the VXAPL, which is the volatility index for Apple. So go look at that. Let's check those out. And I believe you start with that volatility indicator. It'll give you insight to where the market goes. Couple that with the implied volatility of the hedging products out there, and you've got a really good indication of where we could be headed for the next week, 2 weeks, 30 days or so. I like to look out 90 days, but right now with the election next week, it's super volatile. But what I'm seeing is an indication of a bullish attitude from Wall Street. So here's another thing I'm thinking about. I'm looking for 3% moves and the clustering of those moves. So today was a 6.68% on the VVIX, and previous day that was, I believe, a 14 or 17% move. So I'm looking for these clusterings of 3%+ movements. It could be on the top side, it could be on the bottom side. And when you see a multiple of clusterings of 3% movements in, well, any stock or any index or any volatility indicator, it's an indication of possibly of a topping or of a bottoming, and it's the next pivoting point. So instead of looking at the averages, like the 20-day or 50-day or 200-day moving average, look for the particulars, the small pieces of the pie, and look at where we're seeing volume increases and decreases in volume, you know, those kind of things, and look for those 3% clustering moves, and those will give you indication of where we potentially are headed for the coming near future. Take that out on a longer term scale, like a 90-day period of time, 3 months, and you start to see clusterings of 3% clusterings of movement. And they are great indicators of where the directional change we could see in the underlying investment, the overall index, so on and so forth. So you're looking for the particulars, not the averages. You're looking for particular movements that will give you direction of how to best risk manage this market. So yesterday we saw a massive amount of volume on the selling of the S&P 500, way over and above the previous 2 days. Okay, so massive volume, massive move in the volatility or the VIX in relation to the S&P 500, and massive price movement down. Okay, so now today we see massive movement down in the volatility index, okay? And then the S&P 500, on the other hand, went up. And we saw an increase in buying volume there. So is this a pivot point? Have we hit a support level where institutions are coming back into this, these positions, indexes, let's use the S&P 500 as an example, and are they coming back in here and they're starting to buy because now valuations have come down on the underlying positions, because at one point they're just astronomically crazy high and got out totally out of whack. But now we've had a sell-off since, what is that, since October 13th. So that's a number of days of selling, and more selling than buying, and now we've come to maybe a support level. Look for the clustering of the 3% movements. If that, we see that continue, you know, today we saw a clustering of 3%, we most likely will see maybe a clustering tomorrow of 3% movement in the S&P. And what we want to see is that pivoting kind of point, and that's when we make some investment decisions. We allocate or we take some risk off the table. We get risk on or risk off. Volatility and volume and price movement are going to be your true first grouping of indicators to help you make better investment decisions. And today, well, I'm stoked because the volatility has been telling me a lot for the last 20 some odd days since the 1st of October. And we've taken risk off. And now we're looking at, are there opportunities in individual positions that would lead us into the election and then lead us through to the end of the year on a long bullish point of view. Tomorrow, Valerie and I sit down and we do our investment committee meeting and we go through our ideas and we pick apart our individual positions we're in now and we look for opportunities. And every Friday we do that. And I would encourage you to do that every week, once a week at least, and have a game plan as you enter the next week. It's a process. Create a process. Put, you know, ingredients in there that really show you what markets are trending and where they're going and where they're headed. And as you can tell, I'm pretty stoked about price, volume, and volatility. I can't say it enough. So get to know those indicators. They're great ways to start making decisions on where you're headed with your investments. All right, in closing, we've had three of the major FANG companies report earnings. Some did great, some missed, and futures are looking a little shaky here on the night of the 29th. But is there opportunity in these companies as we enter the fourth quarter? Or are some of the indicators that they're indicating a sign of maybe a shift from a stagflation environment, which we're in now, which is rising inflation and falling growth? And I know you're going to argue with me maybe about we're not in an inflationary environment, but the conversation I had with a business owner yesterday, client of ours, who owns a restaurant, and prior to April, he was paying $40 a box for cheese. So think of it as a box, and in each bag is four blocks of, say, cheddar cheese, and there's four bags in that box. Well, prior to April, or prior to June, he was paying $40 a box. Today he's paying $64 a box. That's inflation. He's got to pass that cost on to his patrons of his restaurant. That's inflation. Yet his growth, it's not much more. It's actually converting from a in-store, sitting and having dinner at or lunch or whatever at his place to now takeout. So how can he increase his profits? But the amount of traffic he's getting, it's the same. There's no growth. He says even with now the challenges, people just don't want to cluster in a restaurant anymore, especially in his area. So he's potentially facing decreasing growth, yet his cost of goods are going up, a stagflation environment. The question is are the earnings reports that we're seeing coming out this month for third quarter an indication of a continuing slowing economy? And I'm not talking just about the big boys, the big, behemoth companies. I'm talking about mom and pops. I'm talking about the privately owned companies. Are they seeing growth? If they're not seeing growth and they're seeing an increase in cost of to do business, they're in a stagflation environment, which can always lead to a recessionary or sector four position in the overall economy. So when you're looking at your investments, you're coupling the macro with your indicators to make really good investment decisions. And so as we enter this new era, this new world, when I look at it, because this election is so darn volatile, and the environment we are in a global level, this is a turning point potentially of how we do business, how we create profitability, and how we grow. And that means you've got to be on your game when it comes to investing, and most importantly, risk managing. All right, good luck. And if you need help, just reach out. I'm willing to talk. Take care.